Dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am V.N. Prabhakar from Archaeological Survey of India. In the paper on Principles and Methods of Archaeology, we will be looking about the history of Indian archaeology and the important pioneers who really shaped the Indian archaeology. So in this module, we will try to understand the beginnings of archaeological pursuit in the Indian subcontinent and also to trace the history of important developments that forged the development of archaeology as a discipline. We will also discuss in between, we will not deal separately the personalities involved in the development of Indian archaeology, but in between the developments, we will try to identify a few important pioneers who were responsible in shaping the Indian archaeology. Lastly, we will be restricting to ourselves in the pre-independence era largely, but also we will touch briefly about the scenario of the post-independence era, what kind of developments took place in the post-independence era. So we will be looking into modules. We will be dealing the entire module in different headings, like the earlier terms, the beginnings of archaeology, then different personalities come into picture. So firstly, we start with the Indian historiography. What were the kind of earlier atoms we find in the context of Indian scenario? So it is generally said that we lack proper historical sense or recording of historical data, unlike the Egyptian or the Mesopotamian civilizations. But there are certainly definite instances in the past where historical content is retrievable. We have the epics, we have the Rig Vedic literature and the Puranas, which give a vivid account of the geography of the particular area. So this is also historical data, how during a particular period of time the geography was there, where the rivers are flowing. So all these kind of data can also be retrieved from the ancient literature. One of the important sources of history could be from the Girnar inscription of Junagadh, where three rulers have been mentioned, how the Sudarshana lake was created during the Mauryan period, later how it was repaired on three occasions. So this is a very good account of a historical sense. But in the exact earliest Indian historiography can be traced back to the Kalhanas Rajatarangini, a Kashmiri author who devised various methodology. He even talks about the coins, inscriptions of the bygone eras, even mention about the Mauryan rulers. So he gives a truly historiographical sense of our Indian subcontinent. So this is one such example where a real historiography can be traced in the Indian context. In the later period, we have several examples like the Al-Biruni or the Abul Fazl. They give a very good account also. And one such event which happened is the understanding the importance of Ashokan inscription from Meerut and Thopra by Firoza Tughlaq. Even though he did not understand what it is written on the pillars, but looking into the nature of the pillars and the kind of importance to them, so he managed to transport two of these pillars to Delhi. So this kind of appreciation of the past can also be witnessed from the certain examples. And we have from a large account of the foreign travelers like Xuanzang and Fahian, and the unknown author of the Periplus Maris Erythrae. So we have a very good account of the Indian subcontinent, what could be the nature of the cities and towns, and also a certain other important aspects of the population. So these were all going on, and due to the increase of the trade activities happening between the Indian subcontinent and the European countries starting from around 1600 CE onwards, many travelers were visiting the Indian subcontinent. Like there were people like Marco Polo, Vasco de Gama, and William Finch, Niccolo Conti. There are many people, they were coming and they were visiting the historical places like Ashokan pillars of Delhi and Allahabad was done by William Finch. Then he also visited the Delhi, Agra, Lahore, Gwalior, Mandu monuments and gave an account of the architecture. So these kind of things were happening slowly starting from the period from the 15th and 16th century onwards. So we get a very good account of our monuments and the local places, historical places from these foreign accounts, and it's a very good account also. This also developed an interest among other scholars also to write, to visit, to document and survey these monuments and publish them as archaeology and volumes of important publications. Thus, many scholars were being attracted, and during this period we also see examples of how our ancient literature were being appreciated. There is an earliest example of compilation of Sanskrit grammar in Latin by one scholar known as Hansden. Then a translation of Sanskrit literature exposing the richness of Rig Veda, and Aitreya Brahmana by a scholar known as Calmet in 1731. So the people, they were slowly understanding the richness of our ancient literature. It is being translated to other languages so that the other population, other set of scholars can also understand and appreciate our ancient past. So this sort of appreciation was were being happening, and slowly it led to the more understanding of the Indian subcontinent. In this regard, the contribution of William Jones is very, very important. He was instrumental in founding the Asiatic Society in 1784 with the initial objectives of inquiring, among other things, into the history, antiquities, art, sciences and literature of Asia. So there were large kind of objectives, and the other objectives, it also include geology and pure mathematics, ethnography, mechanics, geography, religion, mineralogy, politics, grammar. So various subjects were being incorporated, and every object and every association of these kind of subjects with the past could be surveyed by the Asiatic Society. So that was the very first attempt towards the later establishment of a proper archaeology discipline in the Indian subcontinent. So the contribution of William Jones is much enormous. He was able to identify the Mauryan ruler Chandragupta Maurya with Chandrakotas of these classical writers, and also association of Alexander the Great, because they were contemporary, and so these kind of associations were made for the first time by William Jones. He also located the ancient Pataliputra, which was the Paliputra of the classical writings at the confluence of Ganga and so on. So these are all really landmark achievements. And another important contribution of William Jones is that he identified the affinities between the Greek, Latin and Celtic and German language group with the Sanskrit and Persian language group. So this is another very important concept of how the languages could have originated, because there are certain commonalities between these languages. So this was another major contribution of William Jones. During the same period also, other developments were taking place after the establishment of the Asiatic Society. The Kutila script, it was deciphered by Charles Wilkins. It is another important achievement, because now the inscriptions of the early medieval and Gupta period can be easily studied. So this kind of decipherments and understanding of the ancient inscription, it led to the development of a separate subject known as the epigraphy, and more inscriptions were being studied by several scholars. Some of the important contributions is by Colebrook and H.H. Wilson. They published them in the Indian Antiquary and the Ariana Antiqua. So these were important publications. Indian Antiquary is an important publication started during this period to have articles of various investigations into the epigraphy, history and several other aspects. So similarly, the Indian subcontinent is also rich in Islamic monuments and antiquities. They were also being studied by several scholars, like the Qutub Minar. It was studied by James Blunt, inscriptions of the Qutub Minar by Walter Ever, and monuments of Vijaypur by Moore. So these people were also independently. It's not any government is intervening or any institution is telling them, but based on their own interest and also in close association with the heritage, they were studying the monuments, and they are also bringing out publication in the important journals and also an individual publications. So similarly, other aspects are also being studied, like the caves of the Maharashtra at Ellora, Kanheri, Ajanta and Elephanta, because these were also discovered, like Ajanta caves, it was discovered in 1819 accidentally. So the discovery led to again visit by various scholars, identification and association with the culture and history, and they were being documented and published. One such important contribution is by James Todd. He surveyed the entire Rajputana region, Rajasthan, the modern Rajasthan region, and brought out a publication in the Annals and Antiquities of Rajasthan. So these were important contributions. Similarly, we have enormous contribution by Colin McKenzie, who was the Surveyor General of India since 1815, and he has brought out an enormous wealth of documentation consisting of 2,630 measure drawings, 78 plans. He discovered 6,218 coins, 106 images, and copying of 8,076 inscriptions. So he was surveying exhaustively the southern Indian region, and he also documenting the megalithic monument in South India. So this is an important contribution by Colin McKenzie into the archaeological aspect of South India. So another aspect is the documentation, how they are documenting during this period. There were no printing press, there were no kind of modern technologies available. So they were making watercolors and engravings and making lithographs and publishing them. So one of the important contribution is by Thomas Daniel, which is even today very, very famous. He published 6 folio volumes with 120 color representations, which were engraved from 1790 to 1809. So these kind of documentation, they are very, very crucial. So if we look into the older documentation, the present day context, we can understand what is the importance of them. One more scholar who was surveying in the Mysore territory is Buchanan. So he started the survey in around 1800, and slowly he extended his investigation to other areas like Dinajpur, Rangpur, Purnia, Bagalpur, Bihar, and other areas, and he published his volumes with at least 500 drawings of various architectural and archaeological features. But the efforts for conservation preservation was lacking. I mean, there was no direct government participation here, but here and there are stray instances. One such instance is the efforts for preservation and appointment of a committee by Lord Minto for the preservation of Taj Mahal, Sikandra, Fatehpur Sikri and Rambagh region. And there are also instances of glaring misuse of monuments during this period. There is even an audacious proposal for dismantlement of the marble of Taj Mahal and auctioning them by Lord Bentinck, but later it was avoided. But one marble bath from Shah Jahan from the Agra fort, it was completely dismantled by Moira and gifted to King George IV. And this is also happening, how they are misusing the archaeological wealth and architectural remains. But unfortunately, later this same marble bath, it was auctioned by Lord Bentinck. He even attempted, as I told you before, to auction the marble of Taj Mahal, but fortunately it was averted. During the same period, the Amaravati Stupa, one of the most stupendous architectural wonder of the early centuries of the common era, it was plundered completely by a local zamindar who wanted the limestone pieces from this Amaravati Stupa for creating for manufacturing lime. So such instances were also happening, and side by side the governments, the local governments, because there was no concept of the central government during that period of time, there were governments by the British companies in Bengal and Madras. So they passed separate regulations known as the Bengal Regulation of 1810 and Madras Regulation of 1817. This enabled to a certain extent the government can interfere for the protection of the buildings which are under their custody, but not the private individuals. So these things were also happening as some stray instances, and not a concerted effort was there for understanding the preservation of archaeological remains. So we have during this period one of the most important contributions of James Prinsep, because if you look into the kind of contribution made by him, he deciphered the scripts of Brahmi and Kharosthi. These were the two important scripts used in the early centuries preceding the common era. The Mauryans, they were using the script of Brahmi, and during the Kushana period they were using Kushana, and the Indo-Greek period they were using the Kharoshthi. So the Brahmi script was discovered by Prinsep looking into the votive and label inscriptions of the Sanchi. So all these votive inscription and the label inscription, they end with a word known as Danam. So it was identified as a Danam. It's a donation related to that pillar or some activity, and it slowly led to the identification of Piyadasi from the Ashokan inscription, and slowly James Prinsep to crack the entire Brahmi script. Similarly, the Kharoshthi script, which was used in the Indo-Greek coins, they had this bilingual legends on the Indo-Greek coins. One side it is the Greek legend, and the other side it is the Kharoshthi legend written in the Prakrit language. So they could understand the similarity, and it was deciphered. So this is the most important contribution of Prinsep, and also it led to the beginnings of the actual archaeology in India, because slowly the people were able to read all the inscriptions coming from the very early age and slowly understand the history of our past. So other important contributions of Prinsep is that he identified three Hellenistic kings mentioned in the Ashokan inscription, namely Antiochus, Ptolemy and Magas of Cyrene. So they are mentioned in the Ashokan edict of Girnar, and which clearly established a chronological contemporariness of the Ashokan Ashoka with the Western rulers. So these things were very, very remarkable in fixing a chronological time frame. Other scholars who were active during this period, as James Ferguson and Colonel Meadows Taylor, they were remarkable in documenting the rocket temples and the megalithic monuments by Meadows Taylor, and cave temples by James Ferguson. So the wealth which is being discovered at various places, they were being documented. The efforts of various scholars like the Ajanta and Ellora, they were being documented, and several people they were doing the documentation also. Kittu is one such important personality who took the task of surveying Bihar and Benaras. Then Kalinger was being documented by Maisi. Captain Gill, he was documenting the Ajanta paintings and drawing them. So these kind of things were happening side by side. I mean, they are happening for the most important monuments. It's not as a overall concept of archaeology as a discipline, but slowly the concept of archaeology is emerging. So this also led to the founding of Archaeological Society of Delhi in 1847, but even though it did not last long, it had a wide range of objectives of documentation, producing plans, drawings and elevations, historical researches both in and around Delhi. So but they had a very good kind of objectives, but that did not last long, unfortunately. So next comes a very important stage. I mean, we have been seeing about how during the earliest phases William Jones was responsible for founding the Asiatic Society, how James Prinsep was really deciphering the scripts of our past. But the real sense of archaeology started from the days of Alexander Cunningham. Alexander Cunningham, who followed the footprints of James Prinsep, was very much interested in the Indian archaeology, and even in 1848 he submitted a proposal to the government of India to carry out a nationwide survey of archaeological remains, but that was not considered by the government of India. But ultimately, during the period of Lord Canning, who understood the necessity of survey, and the government is doing very less in this regard, so he appointed Cunningham as a archaeological survey for doing surveys in the northern India, mainly in the northern India, and Alexander Cunningham joined the survey in December 1861. But even then, the conservation and preservation activities were left out of the purview of Alexander Cunningham. So Alexander Cunningham started his investigation largely following the footprints of Chinese travelers Xuanzang and Fahian. Then he identified most important sites visited by the Chinese travelers. He located on the map, he draw plans and elevations. He also dig sporadic excavations, and all these things were being done by him. And another important contribution of Cunningham is that he identified Alexander of Epirus from the Ashokan rock edict of Kalsi. So already three rulers of West Asia were identified by James Prinsep, and another fourth one was identified by Cunningham, and after that one more king was identified. So Alexander the king of Mauryan ruler Ashoka, he was identified with four or five major rulers who were ruling in West Asia, Egypt and other regions. So but Cunningham, he within the 4 years of his appointment, he could cover a very vast area in the northern plains. He covered Gaya in the east to River Indus in the west, and in the north from Kalsi and Damnar caves to the south. So he covered a very, very wide area. So but largely these were following the Chinese travelers and Chinese travelers. So the prehistoric investigations were largely out of the purview of archaeological survey, but individuals like Robert Bruce Foote, even though he was a geologist, he identified paleoliths and neolithes from South India, and slowly he extended his activities with other geologists and discovered sites like Athrampakkam, Pallavaram, from where the horizon of Paleolithic India was being understood. And interestingly, during this period, 1863, the government they passed a resolution to prevent injury and to preserve buildings remarkable for their antiquity or their historical and archaeological value. So some sort of understanding is also being emerging in the government to also conserve and preserve the archaeological remains, even though mainly the survey of the antiquarian remains and archaeological wealth was in the focus. But unfortunately, the ASA was abolished in 1866, but later revived in 1871 due to the efforts of Duke of Argyll. And again, Cunningham was reappointed as a director general. Initially, he was the archaeological surveyor, but now he was appointed as a director general of the archaeological survey, and with an objectives of survey of the whole country and a systematic record and description of architectural and other remains that are either remarkable for their antiquity or their beauty. So now the scope of the survey was expanding much, much wider. Initially, he was responsible for the North India. Now he is responsible for the entire country. So this was a very long tenure of Cunningham, starting from 1872, because he joined in 1871, but he started the surveys in 1872, and up till 1885 he was doing the surveys and produced a large number of publications in the form of Archaeological Survey of India reports. But unfortunately, one important event happened during this period is that he visited the very famous site of Harappa of the Indus Valley Civilization on three occasions, on 1853, 56 and 1875. But he could not identify the exact cultural location. But he drew the first map of Harappa, which is still followed today. The same kind of nomenclature he gave: Mound AB, Mound E, Mound ET, which is still followed today. But at the same time, Cunningham also understood the necessity of an independent epigraphical survey. So he was instrumental in appointing J.F. Fleet as the government epigraphist in 1883, and the publication of Corpus Inscriptionum Indicarum came into being. This publication, it was dedicated to inscriptions of a particular subject. Like the first volume, it was dedicated to the inscriptions of Mauryan kings, Ashoka and other kings. The second volume, it was on the Kharoshthi inscriptions. Like that, a theme was selected and a large collection of inscriptions were being published. So during the period of Cunningham itself, the directive from the government, it assigned the responsibility of conservation and preservation of buildings of historical and archaeological interest to the local government. There were local provincial governments, the central government, it was not taking much responsibility on this preservation aspects, and they were assigning the local government responsible for the conservation and preservation. But the first major act of 1878, the Treasure True Act, it was passed to prevent the despoiling of archaeological remains by treasure hunters. This was a major contribution, and understanding later the necessity of conservation and overlook the conservation activities by the center, Major Cole was appointed as a curator for preservation of monuments in 1881. But the conservation, again, it was kept outside the purview of the survey, and later Cunningham retired in 1885. So these things are happening, and the end of the Cunningham era, which started in 1861, literally extending in two terms from 1861 to 1866 and 1871 to 1885, Cunningham contributed a lot. He surveyed many parts of the India, produced voluminous volumes, and also instrumental in passing certain acts and regulations. So Cunningham was succeeded by James Burgess. It is the era of James Burgess, which has certain important contributions. So during his period, the government decided to amalgamate all divisions of the survey and place under a single head. So virtually it was under the single control of James Burgess, and he was also instrumental in persuading the government to ban all illegal disposal of antiquities by the public officers, and also the illegal excavations without the consent of Archaeological Survey of India. So a kind of control mechanism was formulated, which might have ultimately led to the promulgation of the Ancient Monuments Preservation Act. So during this period, archaeological publications were also being started. Epigraphia Indica was started, and he started a new publication known as the Archaeological Survey of India, New Imperial Series. So these kind of publications were also started by period of James Burgess. James Burgess, he also started this important publication. So they were considered to be the important landmarks, as they contained the survey reports and also inscriptions which have been found and deciphered. They were also published. James Burgess, he retired in 1889. And before his retirement, he recommended for the abolishment of the Director General's office, and he persuaded the government to a more regional role. So the kind of developments which were happening in the Indian archaeology, the kind of a central control, it came to an end in 1889 due to the retirement of James Burgess, and then started nearly 13-14 years of dark phase, we can say, with no kind of central policy, whatever it may be. But very interestingly, the epigraphal activities, they were continuing under the government epigraphist Hulsh. So he was carrying out the publication. Epigraphia Indica was being continued, and the revival of the Indian antiquary, which was started much, much earlier. Fortunately, the government at that point of time, it reviewed the status of the survey in 1895, and due to the recommendations of various people, scholars at the point of time, like Tawney, Bueller, Fleet, and even the Royal Asiatic Society, they recommended for a complete reorganization of the archaeological work. So, five regional offices were created by the then government, consisting of different regions. One is Bombay with Sindh and Berar, Madras and Coorg was the second one, Punjab, Balochistan and Ajmer the third one, Northwestern provinces and central provinces are the fourth one, and Bengal and Assam. So virtually the entire Indian subcontinent was divided into five regions, and they were placed under separate surveyors who were executing the work. But there was no central kind of agency to overlook them. Then started a very important phase, which we call the Curzon and Marshall era. Curzon, he assumed the charges of the Governor General of India in 1889. That was a very important era. So he revived the post of Director General of Archaeological Survey of India. And based on the recommendation of the British Museum, he appointed Sir John Marshall, who was only 26 years old at that point of time, but he had a very good basic training in the Mediterranean region. So he was appointed as the Director General. But Curzon has a very good view, objectives of what kind of archaeological activities that has to be carried out. So in his In his notes, he gives very exhaustive objectives, and the most important is that it is equally our duty to dig and discover. He says excavation and exploration, then to classify, reproduce and describe, like documentation and publish them, to copy and decipher, and to cherish and conserve. So, in a single sentence, he covers all the aspects of the archaeological pursuits. So, Curzon was also instrumental in reorganization of the survey. So, he included new areas into the already existing circles, and Marshall joining in 1902, he revived the scheme of exploration and the important sites like Nalanda, Vaishali, Pataliputra, Bhita, Takshila, Harappan, Mohenjo-daro were excavated during his period, and he carried out the explorations through other important scholars also, like Alexander Ree. He was continuing his survey in the southern India. John Marshall, he was also instrumental in passing the Ancient Monument Preservation Act of 1904. It was primarily meant for the protection, conservation and preservation of monuments. And an important development happened after the devolution rules of 1921, which placed the archaeology as a central subject. So, the archaeology was achieving more and more important role now because of these decisions by the government of India, and it helped in developing the archaeology as a more central discipline and gaining more control. This important decision by the government, it brought all the monuments that were preserved and protected under 1904 with the central government, and left all the unprotected with the provincial government. Previously, there was no control by the government on the protected monuments. Now, with this decision in 1921, all the protected monuments came under the control of the Archaeological Survey. During this period, a separate exploration branch was started by Sir John Marshall. As I told you before, important sites were excavated, but Marshall had special attention for Sanchi, Takshila and Sarnath. At Takshila, he excavated for more than 20 years, unearthing three phases of the city and also many other important features relating to the Buddhist remains. So, he was concentrating much of energy at Takshila, but he was also very much important in excavating at Sanchi, documenting the remains and publishing three volumes of the work done there. But the most stupendous achievement of Sir John Marshall is the discovery of the Indus Valley Civilization in 1924. The excavation at Harappa and Mohenjo-daro, they were being carried out simultaneously. And when Marshall compared both the materials in 1924, so he immediately understood the importance of the civilization. He published that in the illustrated London News in 1924, which was immediately supported by other scholars like A.H. Sais. He was working in Mesopotamia, who noted similar antiquities in Mesopotamia. And so, the third millennium BCE date was given to the Indus Valley Civilization. So, this was a most important achievement during the period of Marshall. And during Marshall's era, one more important scholar, Aurel Stein, he was working extensively. He was surveying the northwestern part of the India in Baluchistan, Makran coast and also the Chinese Turkestan region, where he discovered large number of inscriptions in Kharoshthi and the Brahmi inscriptions, murals, textiles, all documentations which later formed an important component of the New Delhi Museum. So, these kind of activities were going on, and in the front of the conservation, the contribution of Marshall is much enormous. He laid down the conservation policy, the principles behind the archaeological conservation, ultimately led to the publication of a manual in conservation practices. He also introduced the concept of archaeological museum. He was instrumental in opening up museums at Agra, New Delhi, Delhi Fort, Lahore Fort, and also the excavated sites at Takshila, Sarnath and Sanchi. So, these kind of things were developing, and looking into these examples, museum at other places were also created to cater to the education of the public. So, these were also happening during the Marshall's era. So, the publication also received much attention during Marshall's period. New publications like the Epigraphia Indica, which was already under publication, but a component was added for the Arabic and Persian inscriptions in 1903. Then Marshall started a new series of publications known as the Annual Reports of the Archaeological Survey of India, which contained annual account of whatever activities, exploration, excavation, conservation of the Archaeological Survey of India. It gives a detailed account. And later he started another publication known as the Mummiers of the Archaeological Survey of India. Each mummier, it concentrated on a particular topic of any aspect of archaeology, and they were also published annually. Marshall, after serving for nearly 26 years, he relinquished his charge in 1928, but he was asked to continue up to 1934 to continue the excavation and supervise the excavation at Takshila. But also he had other responsibilities of making a very good publication of these excavations at Mohenjo-daro, which he published in two volumes, and also the monuments of Sanchi in three volumes. So these kind of achievements were there. But after Marshall left in 1928, we enter into a new phase again between 1928 and 1944. It is described here as the post-Marshall era. So he was succeeded by the first Indian Director General of Archaeology, Dayaram Sahani, who was initially working under him, later by Balkistan, and later K.N. Dixit. So they consisted, they are the chief architects during this period from 28 to 44, and K.N. Dixit, he assumed charges 1937. He continued up to 1944. And during his period, ancient and historical monuments, including the archaeological sites and remains, they were declared as a federal subject, a central subject, and thus the central government could rest all powers related to management, preservation and conservation from the provincial government. And again, one another important decision took place in 1932 was to enable the foreign institutions to work on the protected site. So under this relaxing the rules, the Chanhudado site was excavated by American School of Indic and Iranian Studies and the Boston Museum of Fine Arts. So they could excavate the other Harappan site of Chanhudado. So these things were also happening, certain relaxation in rules and also letting other institutions to work. But another important aspect took place during this period. Government appointed Leonard Woolley, a renowned archaeologist at the point of time, to submit, to scrutinize the working of the survey and to submit a report. Leonard Woolley, totally condemned the functioning of the Archaeological Survey of India at that point of time. He focused on the very poor policy, selection of the sites, and how the deeper levels were not probed by the Archaeological Survey, and how the stratigraphy was being denied in understanding the earlier parts of the earlier phases of the site. So he also advised for the appointment of an advisor on archaeology, specialist in Stone Age antiquities, and also allowing Indian and foreign institutions like universities and other institutions to excavate. So these kind of recommendations were given by Woolley, and he also recommended the excavation of some important sites, and the topmost in his list was Ahichatra. So Ahichatra in western Uttar Pradesh is a very important site dating back to 2nd millennium BCE, and it was excavated between 1941 to 1944 by K.N. Dixit, and this excavation brought to light two important ceramic complexes of northern India, which later came to be known as the painted grey ware and the northern black polished ware. So in the midst of the excavations, K.N. Dixit retired in 1944, which led to the appointment of Sir Mortimer Wheeler as the Director General, new Director General of Archaeology in 1944. Thus starts the Wheeler era. It's a new phase in Indian archaeology, the new phase of scientific pursuits in Indian archaeology, the kind of investigations initiated by Wheeler, they were remarkable during the period of time. He reorganized the survey on many aspects. He introduced many scientific methods in excavation, set up an excavation branch exclusively for carrying out this kind of pursuits, and also created posts of archaeological chemist and conservation activities he took under the overall purview of the survey. So all conservation activities which were with the provincial governments now came under the direct control of the survey. So these are the important contributions of Wheeler. So he also initiated several training programs in conservation, techniques of excavation, preparation of field records, surveying, photography, not only for the survey officers and the officials, but also select candidates from the universities, research institutions across India. So this was a very good training program which stabilized the archaeology during that period. So he also started some important publications, a bulletin known as the Ancient India, which contained important publications on excavations, explorations, technical notes, and it was started by Wheeler. Further, he also set up the Central Board of Advisory Board of Archaeology. The Central Advisory Board of Archaeology was having an objective to interact, to inculcate a practice, to involve all institutions at that point of time to develop interaction between the universities and the Archaeological Survey of India, to devolve the central role of archaeology so that the universities they can take up archaeology as a subject and develop, and that's how each and every university have an archaeological department. Slowly the task of the government, it was devolved and it was decentralized so that many universities they can take up. So another contribution during the Wheeler era is that he re-excavated Harappa in the 1945, and he discovered the relation between the symmetry H and symmetry R37, and he established that symmetry H is a later period and the symmetry R37 it belongs to an earlier period. But he also made an hypothesis that the symmetry H burial belongs to the associated with the invading Aryans who are responsible for the destroying of Indus Valley civilization, which was disproved later on based on anthropological and other historical accounts. Wheeler also identified three important sites: Takshila in the north, Brahmagiri in the south, and Archimede in the south, to solve certain chronological issues of the Indian archaeology. And Archimede he selected particularly to understand the artifacts related to the Roman world at that point of time. So ultimately Archimede proved out to be an important port town, also mentioned in the classical writings. So Wheeler retired in 1948 after the independence of the India. So he was followed by the Indian Director Generals who led the Archaeological Survey of India, and the constitution, India achieving the republic status in 1950, the constitution of India made the following categories. They are known as the Union List, which included all monuments and sites declared by the parliament to be of national importance, State List, which outside this protection of national importance, whatever is there, it was a responsibility of the state. And there is a concurrent list where the center and states were vested with the concurrent jurisdiction of those monuments and sites which does not come under either the center and the state. So these were some of the remarkable events. And during the post-independence era, we have now a better understanding of the archaeological pursuits. We understand various cultural periods in a better manner with the application of sciences in archaeology, with the advent of radiocarbon dates in archaeology. We have a very good understanding. Also, the role of universities and research institutions, it is a commendable lot who have done major field work across the length and breadth of the country, and they have brought out various aspects and discovered new sites, discovered new aspects of our culture. And also the promulgation of two important acts, one in 1958 and another in 1972, they made provisions for the preservation and conservation of monuments and antiquities in a better manner. But the most important aspect during the post-independence era is the World Heritage Convention passed by the UNESCO. So it's a concept of monuments and properties of universal heritage. So that is something like that, not only the cultural heritage, it belongs to the local government, it also belongs to the entire humankind. So that was the concept introduced by the UNESCO in 1972, and India is a signatory to that convention, and we have 36 World Heritage properties now inscribed in the list. We have 29 cultural properties, 6 natural properties and one mixed property. So we have our representation in the UNESCO in a bigger manner. We have some remarkable discoveries made in the post-independence era. One such discovery is discovery of a human fossil identified as archaic Homo sapiens, datable to around 150,000 years to 200,000 years from Hathnora in the Narmada Valley by a geologist. We have better understanding of the prehistory in the present moment. Some of the very important excavations being at Bimbetka, carried out by the Deccan College, and Athrampakkam in South India, which has a date, absolute date, done by the excavator Shanti Pappu, which gives a date of 1.5 to 1.7 million years ago. Some more important excavations were also being conducted in the Neolithic culture of Gangetic Plains, and even the Mesolithic culture of the Gangetic Plains. We have sites like Koldihava, Mahagra, Mahadaha, which gives very good understanding of the culture, emergence of culture there. Similarly, we have a very good understanding of the settlement pattern of the Harappan civilization, because during partition, many of the sites went to the Pakistan side, and we didn't have the Indian scenario. So prolonged exploration activities by the universities, Archaeological Survey of India and other research institutions, many sites were discovered in Gujarat, Rajasthan and Punjab. And now we understood a better manner how this culture originated during the 3rd millennium BC and spread to a very wide area, and how it has slowly declined. So looking back in this module, we have traced the Indian archaeology from the very earliest to the recent past. We have discussed its history along with important pioneers who contributed side by side, and it has to be admitted that we cannot discuss all pioneers or all scholars who have really contributed for the development of the Indian archaeology, but an attempt has been made to at least introduce these pioneers, so that you can go on and refer more and more literature and know about much more. You can also understand how the scope and objectives was of archaeology was defined initially as a discipline, and later the government also took control of that, and how they regulated certain activities. Important discoveries and the contributions of the pioneers help us in understanding the role of government, also institutions and individuals, in shaping this discipline. You can refer to the e-text quadrant to know more about that, because it has been dealt in a much elaborate manner, and other quadrants of this module to understand better. Thank you.